On land, it's always rush hour somewhere. Highways are jammed with vehicles spewing carbon dioxide that plays a role in warming the planet. The ocean also has a daily commute. But instead of cars, this commute involves tiny aquatic plants called phytoplankton that help soak up carbon dioxide produced by burning fossil fuels, shielding us from the harmful impacts of climate change. Phytoplankton are an important part of the biological pump, a carbon superhighway that takes carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and transports it down into the deep ocean. The biological pump starts when phytoplankton in surface waters use sunlight to grow by taking up carbon. Tiny animals, called zooplankton, gobble up the phytoplankton and poop out little carbon-rich pellets. Fragments of phytoplankton, bits of zooplankton poop, and particles of other dead organisms all sink through the water column. As the particles fall, they are eaten up in the deep ocean and transformed into carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide then gets trapped in the deep water layers, staying out of contact with the atmosphere for a few thousand years. We've learned more about the biological pump thanks to hundreds of robotic floats traveling the world's oceans, collecting data about ocean health and transmitting it back to scientists on shore. These floats are part of an international research program called Biogeochemical-Argo. And one thing they do is provide data to estimate carbon in the ocean. These three globes show how much carbon there is in the Southern Ocean at different depths. Each little dot is a float, and the dot's color changes depending on how much carbon the float detects. Green means more, and brown means less. See all the green dots at the surface? Those sunlit waters have the most carbon, because that's where the phytoplankton can use sunlight to photosynthesize and grow. Now, let's take some of this data from this section of the Southern Ocean and look at it on a graph of carbon versus depth. The carbon superhighway grows and shrinks depending on the month. During the Southern Ocean's spring and summer months, carbon at the surface spikes as the waters warm and phytoplankton bloom. As those phytoplankton are eaten or die, the carbon they carry is further broken down by other organisms as it sinks, until whatever little remains reaches the seafloor. Thanks to the data from these floats, scientists can better estimate just how much carbon is produced in the ocean and how much carbon dioxide actually makes it to the deep ocean to be locked away. However, as oceans continue to warm, these patterns that we see might change. As the heart of Earth's climate system, the ocean currently protects us by soaking up about 25% of the total human carbon emissions per year. And the biological pump is a big reason why. But these climate services come at a cost to ocean health. The phytoplankton and zooplankton that power the carbon superhighway come in a whole variety of species. Some species are better than others at transporting carbon down the highway, and each species reacts differently to changes in temperature, salinity, and even wind patterns at the ocean's surface. As these conditions alter with climate change, responding shifts in plankton populations will influence just how effective the biological pump continues to be. The slower the carbon superhighway, the less carbon the ocean can store, and the faster our planet warms. That's why the real-time information collected by biogeochemical Argo floats is so important. By giving us a window into the carbon superhighway and other ocean processes, these floats are helping scientists to better understand and predict the impacts of climate change to improve ocean health.